Hey, what's up guys? In today's video, we're going to build a simple racing game with Engine Simulator and a new game engine that I've created. But first, I'd like to thank BeamNG, Reyna, Goldwolf, and Meister for supporting me at the Master Mechanic level on Patreon. Thanks also to Squarespace for sponsoring this video. More about them later. By the way, yes, that is actually the real BeamNG. I've gotten quite a lot of comments asking about that. They've been an active supporter since my Patreon first launched, and I've spoken to their CEO and some of their developers on a video call, and I can honestly say that their entire team is amazing. I can tell that they really care about the community and want to help smaller creators like myself. Anyway, they didn't ask me to say this, I just thought I would clarify, since some of you were wondering. If you're new to the channel, a few months ago I released this video about a real-time internal combustion engine simulator that generates audio. That video did a lot better than I was expecting, and we got enough funding on Patreon to start developing the prototype engine simulator into a complete tool, which will have a much more polished 3D graphical interface, better audio generation, and overall just be a better product. Starting off with the foundation, we need a game engine. The free version of Engine Simulator uses a game engine called Delta Studio, which was a project I started in high school. Those were very different times, and I've learned a lot since then, so let's just say it's not the best game engine ever made, and I want to make sure that this product is something that I would be comfortable selling. So I built an entirely new game engine. So this game engine supports Vulkan, and it has a lot of other useful features, like logging and error checking, and other things that my teenage self thought were 100% optional. It's not quite done yet, but I'm going to continue working on it in parallel with the Engine Simulator project. I linked all the resources I use in the description in case you want to try Vulkan for yourself. Just a warning though, it will test you, okay? It's a lot of work, but if you like that kind of thing, it's definitely worth trying. Even though there are some important features that are missing, I thought it would be cool to try making a simple game with this new game engine, something that'll just take 2 or 3 days of work. A logical choice would be some sort of driving simulator that uses Engine Simulator to generate audio. Well, that's exactly what we'll build right after a quick message from today's sponsor, Squarespace. Having an online presence in this day and age is important for pretty much anyone. Thankfully, Squarespace makes it easy to get a domain and start building a website with an easy-to-use interface. They also offer a variety of modern features for creators like myself who rely on online supporters to make a living. The Member Areas feature allows creators to make money from the content they create and build a community. Squarespace also integrates easily with other social media and provides detailed analytics to help you grow even more. Check out squarespace.com to start your free trial, and when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/angethegreat to save 10% on your first purchase of a domain or website. Thanks again to Squarespace for making this video possible. Alright, let's start with the car physics. We'll use the same physics engine that runs Engine Simulator. If you want to learn about the mathematics and theory behind this physics engine, check out the video that I made on that project. We can model a vehicle as a system of constraints. So we have the car frame and 4 wheels that are rigidly attached to that frame. The first constraint prevents the tires from sliding, and here is the code for that constraint. Next, we need a rolling constraint that forces the wheels to rotate at a rate that ensures that the velocity at the bottom of the wheel where it contacts the ground is zero. And this is what that constraint looks like. Now, these constraints together will completely prevent the tire from sliding, but we know that in real life, tires can and do slide. To account for this, we can specify a force limit to the constraints we defined earlier. Since the engine can only apply a force up to that limit to satisfy the constraint, there will be cases where the constraint cannot be entirely satisfied and the wheel will slip. To test this model, I used the demo program for my physics engine video. Now, I know it looks a little bit strange, but there is order to the chaos here. To represent the 3D nature of the tires in this 2D application, the tires are shown as this outer disc and the tire direction is this inner disc with the dot pointing forward. As you can see, once the maximum friction force is exceeded, the car will begin to slide. Now we can port this model to a new project that uses the game engine that I built earlier. For the wheels, I created some low-poly models in Blender. I kept the same exporter from my previous game engine, And it basically just allows me to export geometry and scene information from Blender. After fixing some reality bending issues with the matrix transformations I was using, I now had the basic car simulation inside the game, and the next step was to bring in the engine simulation code. A major issue is the larger a system is, the more processor intensive it is. A V8 has 16 reciprocating components and numerous links and constraints between those components. Linking an entire car simulation onto this will probably be too much for most CPUs to handle. However, there is a way to cheat. We can separate the engine from the car and then couple the two systems with a spring rather than rigidly connecting them together. This is faster because the processing cost scales non-linearly with respect to the number of constraints and bodies, so separating the workload into two separate halves will dramatically reduce the computation time of the composite system. The only issue is, a spring connection between the engine and the wheels is less accurate and the result can be jittery. However, I found that I don't mind the jitter that much and I think it sounds interesting. I'll show you what it sounds like in a minute. Once I had implemented a few camera controllers, it was actually kind of playable. Obviously, the physics is very unsophisticated, but it's honestly not that bad to play. There are also no collisions, so the track boundary is just visual, but adding collision detection is theoretically possible. The only thing left is to make it look a little bit more appealing. Right now, I'm just rendering all the objects using their vertex normal as their color. I modeled a completely new course in Blender and also started adding some interesting decorations to the level. I was inspired by the test shaders I was using earlier, and I decided to try some sort of cosmic theme for the game, and I ended up really liking it. These unintentional discoveries happen pretty often when you do things completely from scratch, and it's one of the reasons why I like doing things that way. I put a lot of thought into which game engine I was going to use for this project. It's a real dilemma because tools like Unity and Unreal are so good, it's kind of hard to justify not using them. Now, I don't blame anyone for using those engines, but I'm just going to be honest, I don't find them that fun to use, and there's something about them that interrupts my creative process. I think having restrictions leads to creativity in a lot of cases, and game engines today are just so complete and so polished, I don't know if genuine restrictions like this even exist anymore. Anyway, my point is, I like using my own tools, and it makes the entire process of game development enjoyable for me. But everyone is different, and I'm not going to claim that using my own game engine makes me better or some sort of GigaChad programmer. Especially today, there's so much information online and resources. Pretty much anyone can do it if they have an interest in that kind of thing, which I do. Also, if you're not a software developer and you're watching this, welcome to the world of devlogs. It's a small but growing genre here on YouTube, and there are a lot of great developers that document their work on their own games. I've left some links in the description to some good ones that I would recommend. Around 2 years ago, when I was still working on this cereal box platformer game, an absolute GigaChad named Krebs gave me a shout-out just as I was reaching 100 subscribers. It was a really big deal for me at the time, and I'd like to finally repay him with my own shout-out. Please go and give this legend some support. He hasn't uploaded in 2 years, but let's see if we can bring him back. I actually did go through the effort of writing some decent shaders for this project, but I found that they just didn't look that interesting. Something looked very default about them, if that makes sense. Anyway, I designed some fake lighting using dot products and simple vector math. I found that it actually worked better for the aesthetic that I was going for in this project. If I had weeks to work on this, I could probably come up with something better, but I think this is fine for a few hours of work. The entire shader model is as follows. So first we apply a very basic point source light. This is literally just a single dot product, and it mixes a front-facing and rear-facing color. Next, we multiply this result by another very simple light with a different color, and this creates kind of an accent color in the scene. It's a bit dark, so we can also increase the exposure for the entire scene as well. Now, to fix this oversaturation, we can apply gamma correction and then a tone mapping function. Now we can start applying some cool Fresnel effects using this approximation, which makes some objects brighter at grazing angles. Some objects have even more of this applied to create kind of a halo effect, which I think fits with the cosmic theme of the scene. Finally, we can apply a fade effect so these towers look like they disappear into the nothingness of space. Technically, there isn't really a physical basis for this, but none of the shaders in the scene are really physically based anyway. Now, don't get me wrong, I like physically based rendering, and I've even written my own physically based ray tracer, but I find that it's fun to break the rules sometimes and create interesting effects. Alright, that's pretty much it. Let's do a test run. I know that sim racing fans are gonna cringe at my racing lines, but please try to ignore my extremely bad driving. I don't have a steering wheel or a controller, so this is the best that I could do with a keyboard and mouse. I put this overlay on the screen so you can see the controls. Most are the same as the Engine Simulator client, where Q, W, E, and R keys are throttle, shift is clutch, left click is to shift up, right click to shift down, and middle click is to brake. Moving the mouse side to side is what turns the steering wheel, which is why it looks so smooth in the game. In the top left corner, you can see the frame rate. This is from an overlay from RenderDoc. My screen capture software misses frames sometimes, I'm not really sure why, but the overlay proves that I'm getting a pretty decent frame rate, and this is totally playable on my hardware. Anyway, let's try it. All of my supporters on Patreon will get a free copy of this demo. It works with any Engine Simulator engine, and I'm planning to have a similar minigame in the final game so players can test out their engines in a more interesting way instead of just running through gears looking at a speedometer on the screen. Thanks to all my patrons and Squarespace for sponsoring this video, and thank you for watching. Alright, have a great day, everyone.